Look, a lot of people think how the market goes dictates how people think the economy is going. Mm-hmm. Okay. So what has happened because of this outlook and because of Powell's comments is we have seen the market on a tear here really since October of 2023. Now, Dean Barber here along with Bud Kasper talking about something that is a bit unpredictable. So as we talk about this today, we're going to be giving our opinions. I'll call them educated opinions. However,
guesses.
There's no crystal ball here. So the question I think that we have to ask, Bud, is how hot is too hot and how cool is too cool? And of course, what I mean by hot and cold is our annualized inflation numbers. In other words, how quickly are things getting more expensive overall? How hot's too hot?
Well, gee, that's a subjective type of answer for you to be able to come up with. But let's just put it in current dollars and cents from that perspective, Dean. And what I'm saying is, when we look at February, we had an increase of 0.4%. So that was up higher than what they had anticipated. So the overall core rate has increased as well. Now, it doesn't seem like a lot. It was 0.3 in January, 0.4 in February. It doesn't seem like a big number, but is it a trend? Is it something that Powell's going to have to readdress by doing what? Going in and raising rates further when the entire world is waiting for him to drop rates?
So we're going to dive into that, Bud. And I think if you are looking at this from Jerome Powell's perspective, anything above 2% on an annualized basis is too hot. Mm-hmm. Anything below 2% is too cool. And we definitely don't want to go into a negative GDP number, which then puts us into the possibility of a recession. So if we look at the February numbers, you mentioned that February's the monthly increase was 0.4%. Mm-hmm. If we annualize that out, that's right. Way too hot because that's going to exceed 5%.
Okay? Which is defeating the purpose of what they've been doing since they started this, which goes back to September of 2022 when the inflation rate was 6.6.
Right. And it topped out at 9.1. We'll get into kind of all those statistics. If we look at year over year, things were 3.2% more expensive in February of 2024 than they were in February of 2023. So I want to make sure that we're really crystal clear on this before we get too deep. People are saying inflation is cooling. Okay. The current administration is twisting this into prices are coming down. That's not the case. And I don't think any person that shops for groceries is going to say, yeah, the prices have come down. No, prices are not increasing as fast as they were, but prices are still increasing. We still have inflationary pressures, though not as strong. It may not continue to accelerate at the same pace. And that's the objective of what Jerome Powell and the rest of the Federal Reserve of jacking interest rates up like they have so much. Now, we've been in a holding pattern here for some time, and we can look around the globe, and we're going to explore that a little bit too, because inflation is not confined specifically to the United States. This inflation phenomenon has been a global inflation phenomenon. So we'll tackle how the Federal Reserve's handling it here. Is this the year of rate cuts for the United States? Is this the year of rate cuts around the globe? Who goes first? Do they do it too soon? Do they wait too long, therefore sending us into a recession? Those are all the things that we have to take into consideration. And of course, all of that monetary policy is going to impact our capital markets, whether it be stocks, bonds, real estate, and the like.
Right. When you look at core PCE, though, which healthcare is the biggest expense associated, anything that's in that industry, if you will. And here's where demographics come into play. So if we go back to our old buddy, Harry Dent, you know, looking at the impact that many times the bigger numbers have on the numbers that we're just quoting with you right now. What do we have? We have an aging population. You know, the boomers are all in their 60s now, some in 70s at this point, and the healthcare expenses are not going down, they're going up. And so that's having an influence on, obviously, the inflation rate, but more importantly, the core CPE rate as well.
So if we look back to 2023, Bud, and we look at the year-over-year increases, if we go January 22 to January 23, it was a 6.4% increase. February of 22 to February of 23, a 6% increase. If we go from July of 22 to July of 23, it was a 3.2% increase. But then from September to September, it was 3.7. And, you know, November to November, November 22 to November 23, 3.1. December to December, 3.4. January to January, 23 to 24, 3.1. February to February, 23 to 24, a 3.2. So what this tells me is that we've got inflation on a year-over-year basis in a pretty tight band right now, mm-hmm. but we don't see evidence that year-over-year inflation is continuing its cooling trend. It seems to have stalled a little bit, and we see that not just here in the United States, but we see it around the globe as well.
Well, when you look at it, core CPE has a factor of food and energy. You know, and so when you take those two big numbers, which impact the inflation rate dramatically, and you look at what's happening, so gas prices have actually come down over the last year. So that's a benefit, you know, to what Chairman Powell and the committee is trying to do with that. When you look at food, however, that's been increasing. So we have a counter, if you will. One's doing better, the other one's doing worse, you know, and that's a key part of it because we have to have gas and we have to eat. So when you look at the element that that has as an influence in the overall inflation factor, it most certainly has a direct impact on it.
You know, one of the things that occurs to people as you're really starting to try to plan for retirement, of course, this is America's Wealth Management Show, and we talk about getting you to and through retirement. The silent killer in retirement is inflation. And we have a lot of experience and have guided people to and through retirement through all kinds of inflationary cycles. So if you want to understand how inflation is actually going to impact your ability to retire and maintain the lifestyle that you want to maintain, you get a retirement plan checklist and then you schedule a meeting so that you can get a conversation started with our team, because we'll show you how each thing that you spend money on an annual basis is inflating at a different rate. Healthcare is inflating at a different rate than food, for an example. Rents are inflating at a different rate. Gasoline, different, right? So how we spend money and what we spend that money on needs to be taken into consideration when you're building your retirement plan, and you need to be applying proper inflation rates to each one of those budget items to get an accurate look at how your portfolio is established and can it actually keep up with inflation as the way that you spend.
Yes. And I was just talking about energy and healthcare. And so when you apply that to what we're experiencing right now, it is pretty obvious that with the healthcare issues that we're facing as a nation, there's really little doubt that that's going to continue to put a lot of pressure on the economy.
So we, there was an article on CNBC just this last week saying, is this the year of rate cuts? And they had some interesting charts that were put out there by a company called Flourish. And I'm not sure, I've not played around with the site, but we can create this same kind of chart through Y charts. But it's interesting, and I'll just show it here for people that are watching on YouTube. You can see it here on camera. It's a CNBC article, is this the year of rate cuts? You can go out there and look at that article, some interesting data. But you can see clearly, Bud, that the Fed has been increasing. And then about mid-year last year, I think it was the August or September, they decided they're going to hold rates steady. And that steady rate hold has been for the last five consecutive Fed meetings where we have had no rate increases, and they've held that Fed funds rate steady. And at the same time, you can see inflation is continuing to decline. We did see an uptick in inflation, and we could go through the month over month numbers and year over year numbers, but it's not been a straight line decline. And we are getting closer to the 2% Fed target, but still, as we talked about in February, we're at that 3.2% rate. You look at the same thing in the Eurozone, right? They jacked their interest rates up just like we did. We see their inflation number falling. You can see the chart here. And their inflation number has fallen more steadily than what ours has, but still they haven't reached that target. You look at Canada, and Canada has actually dipped down into their core target two or three times over the last four or five meetings, and yet they've held rates steady. This goes back to the conversation that we were having earlier. Just because it hits that target on a year-over-year basis, is that the time, that the meeting that then the Fed says we're going to start cutting rates? I don't think so, because this isn't a straight line deal.
Right.
And so a lot of people I think maybe just wishful thinking. We're predicting that in the second quarter of 2024, we might start to see rate cuts. Right. I've never been in that camp. I don't believe you have either. Nope. I've always thought it would be the second half of the year where we might start to see some cuts.
I've been saying that for probably the last 9 months, you know, and it'd be foolhardy for the Federal Reserve to go in and start doing that. It might be popular in a political year. Okay. I hope they don't let politics, they're not supposed to interfere with what we're talking about with that. But, you know, when we're doing planning, getting back to the essence of what we provide our clients in our planning process, we use inflation rates on different parts of the plan. So what I'm saying is when we look at the overall plan, we're going to inflate over 3.5%, but when we also apply on the healthcare side of things over 6.5%. But if you don't use accurate numbers, up-to-date numbers associated with that, regardless of where you're projecting it might be in 6 months or whatever, then we're going to end up getting a false read on the plan in terms of the success that people are looking for that could be defined in the planning process. Let me say that another way, is defined in the planning process. So those elements have to be understood. They have to be applied. Otherwise, the plan is not going to be accurate.
Let me try to translate in English what you just said. If you don't apply the proper inflation rate to the proper places where you're spending money, you're going to get a false positive. And it's not a COVID false positive. It's a false positive on your ability to do what you want to do in retirement. And we've seen too many times, too many instances where people have been working with an advisor that is using a low inflation rate in their retirement projections. And that's giving you false hope that you're actually going to be able to maintain your standard of living through retirement because you're not applying a high enough inflation rate to actually do it. I would rather apply an inflation rate that is above what it winds up being, and putting a little bit extra stress on the plan itself. So that in the event that we have lower inflation than what we project, you know what that means? I can either spend more money or I'm going to pass more money on to the next generation. Where if it's the opposite, it's my standard of living is going
to
suffer.
You know, it takes me back to the movie Orion O'Neill. I can't remember the other lady that was in that. It says love means never having to say you're sorry.
Yeah.
Well, that's the way it is with inflation. We need to get it right because I'm sorry doesn't cut it.
Right.
You know, it means that we didn't use the skills that we have to be able to produce the plan and get as accurate as we can what the results might be without having the correct data.
But I think if you want to look at one of the key factors to building a plan. Obviously, there's a lot that goes into it, right? We really have to understand what a person wants their future to look like. We then apply dollars to it. We then inflate it. But if you don't inflate it properly and you don't measure all the resources you have and those aren't properly allocated and you haven't taken into consideration all the tax ramifications of how you're going to get money out of the different accounts and put it into your bank account to spend, some people want to stop working so bad that some advisors can read that and they'll go, well, let me just make these numbers look a little better.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And they can give you false hope.
Yes, that's right. And so if you're going to be making comparisons of financial plans, as I've said many times, you know, and by the way, it is extremely rare that I have somebody who's been referred into me that has a plan. But if they do, I said, please let me look at the plan. And if I go in there and the first thing I do is look at the inflation rate, and if the inflation rate is 1.5% or 2%, I just simply hand it back to them and said, this is worthless.
Yeah.
Because it's not depicting what the reality is of the current inflation factor. And by the way, projecting inflation into the future. I think Powell made a mistake at the beginning of the year, Dean. And what I mean by that specifically, he indicated that they might cut, the FOMC might cut as many as 3 times in this year. Why would he make that statement when he knows he hasn't hit the target of 2% when it's really about 3.2%? And so I'm lost with what he is. Now he's walked that back and now he's coming up and saying, well, we'll probably have one increase, maybe more, okay? But in my opinion, and I think you agree with me, I don't think he's gonna touch that until after the June. And possibly even later. But now it becomes a political football and people are going to be up in arms if you start seeing creating opportunities for markets to succeed because of the lower rates.
There's a old saying, And I'm not sure exactly what it is. I'll do a George Bush at the Yos in Tennessee. There, no, I'm just kidding.
You can fool me once. Yeah,
no. But look, a lot of people think how the market goes dictates how people think the economy is going. Mm-hmm. Okay. So what has happened because of this outlook and because of Powell's comments is we have seen the market on a tear here really since October of 2023. And it's been pretty much almost a straight up shot where you see the S&P 500 up over 7%, the NASDAQ, of course, better than that. You know, some of your bigger companies out there and more value-oriented companies like the Dow Jones companies, that 30, the average, that's up about 2.5 to 3% this year, so not quite as much. But the thing that concerns me, Bud, is that the markets are moving higher and they are counting on interest rate cuts. The markets are counting on a looser monetary policy, easier money, and the markets like that. Okay. Mm-hmm. So right now we have an S&P 500 that has a price to earnings ratio, according to Case Shiller, of 28.09. And this number was as of March the 7th. Now that number is pretty high. Now, when did we go above that number? We went above that number in 2020 during COVID, and we were up near 37 or 38 during COVID. But remember, a lot of companies' earnings dropped, and they projected forward-looking earnings lower because of all the lockdowns and all of that.
Logical.
You know, a couple of times before that, the dot-com bubble, it exceeded that number, and then the 08 financial crisis, it exceeded that number. We have to go back into the 1930s before we see anything close to that 28 on a price-to-earnings ratio. Fair value during a normal economic time for a price-to-earnings ratio on the S&P 500 should be in the mid to upper teens. Call it 18, 16, 17, somewhere in there. That people could look at that and say that the market is fairly valued at that level. But when we have a market that is valued at 28 times earnings, that's elevated.
That's elevated.
And we just need to realize that. And right. It's elevated. Not necessarily. There's a few factors that are playing into this. Much of it is the anticipation of future rate cuts, but another factor of it is artificial intelligence and the mania around the companies that are, you know, really the main players in this artificial intelligence space, which is really, really new. And it looks a lot like the dot-com bubble, where all these companies are getting into the dot-com world. And this AI world's brand new. I mean, yeah. Really kicked off about a year ago when it's, you know, when ChatGPT came out.
Right.
And, you know, some of those stocks that are heavily involved in AI, they've got price to earnings ratios of 40, 50, 60, 100 times next year's earnings. Is it justified?
Absolutely right. But, you know, at that point, you know, we look at 25, you know, is the number that I heard, earnings, you know, 25 times. So that's probably acceptable is really what I'm saying. As big as AI is, as big as technology is, and let's compare this to the S&P 500. In 2022, S&P was up 19%. I was down 19%. The next year was up 26%. So what are we looking at? A 7% difference between those 2 years divided by two, you made 3.5% per year. But when you look at what AI has done to the component, that component, and I don't think a lot of people know, when you look at the S&P 500, it was created to represent the entire market. And so there's 11 different categories that are inside of that. Technology is one of them, real estate, oil and gas, et cetera, et cetera. But the influence that technology is having currently is, I'm making this up, 10 times what you would ever expect it to be at this point, other than the fact that it's measurable. We're really starting to see what this AI technology can mean to corporation in terms of cost of employees and the efficiencies associated with what they can actually produce because of AI's intelligence.
Well, let's talk about how skewed it is, Bud. You're talking about this big percentage. If you look at the S&P 500 index that is cap weighted, in other words, it's weighted, the amount of money that goes into each stock is based on the capitalization or the size of that company as a percentage of the total value of all 500 companies. You get seven stocks that are making up almost 30% of that weighting.
Yes.
That's where you get that price to earnings ratio of 28. If we do an S&P equal weight, which means if we were to spread the money out evenly, the same amount amongst all 500 stocks,
or 11 sectors.
Now, all of a sudden, your price to earnings ratio on average for all 500 stocks, if you're weighting each stock equally, is about 16.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that you could say is much more fairly valued. And so you could argue that a few stocks that are making up 30% of the capitalization of the S&P 500 are accounting for the vast majority of this elevated price to earnings ratio.
And you and I have never seen that in our lifetime.
Well, we saw it in 99.
Well, 99 was I'll say that was a blip, if you will, from that perspective. But again, we look at this and it's just unbelievable what's happening with this, Dean.
Well, so the question becomes, and we actually had David Mitchell of Lion Bernstein on here not too long ago, where he and I were having the debate, if I'm going to deploy money to the market today and I want to mirror an index, do I go with the S&P 500 cap weighted, where 30% is going to go into those heavy technology companies with elevated price to earnings ratios? Or do I go into the S&P equal weight index, where I'm getting a much better price to earnings ratio, so a much better overall entry point? Which one would you do?
Well, let's look at it from a risk perspective. The equal weighted gives you a smoother ride, an average, if you will. The cap weighted, as you said, the Magnificent Seven, some people say it's a Magnificent Six since Tesla's lost some money recently.
Right.
But let's look at that impact. I'm so glad you brought that up, because if you look at the return that we had last year at 26%, on the S&P 500. And if you were to take those seven companies out, it drops by what, 45%?
You're essentially up slightly on the year, but not a great deal.
So what does that mean? Does that mean that we're making a bet? You know, the technology will continue to get that spread difference between that and the equal weighted?
It's where the money's going.
That's where the money's going.
The question is it smart money or dumb money?
Well, I don't know. If the impact that we're seeing on this is the way it is, we'll find out in the future.
Here's the thing. Understand where your money is, what you're doing. Understand inflation, the impacts of it. Work with a team of professionals. We've got the chartered financial analysts, the certified financial planners, and the CPAs to help construct your plan to get you to and through retirement with confidence and freedom. Thanks for joining us on America's Wealth Management Show. I'm Dean Barber, along with Bud Kasper. Until next time, everybody stay healthy and stay safe.
Views expressed represent the opinion of Modern Wealth Management, LLC, an SEC-registered investment advisor. Information provided is for illustrative purposes only and does not constitute investment, tax, or legal advice. Modern Wealth Management does not accept any liability for the use of the information discussed. Consult with a qualified financial, legal, or tax professional prior to taking any action.